I became the third, I became the lead trumpet player about 2.5 weeks. Let's just leave it at that. And I do know that Ernie said, you know, when they brought me in after that first tour, they were asking me if I wanted to play lead on the next tour, and I didn't think of that. I mean, I didn't care, you know, and so I was his lead player for the next 9 years, and really funny. So many of the guys that came on the band, we had one section together for 3 years. That was just an incredible section with Dennis Nodet, Ron Tooley, and Joe Mazzello, and they all three had higher chops than I did, all of them. I never had real high chops.
Could have fooled us then.
I couldn't really. I never, you know, and that was fun. There's so much more lead playing than high chops, guys. You know, and again, I'm old school, and I'm not a big fan where trumpet playing is gone. As a matter of fact, I'm pretty anti where trumpet playing has gone. But things never stay the same. Nothing ever stays the same. And sound is used to be sound was the most important thing. Sound. I'm not a big fan of the way trumpet players sound. And that's my problem. I would not want to sound like these guys. Lead trumpet playing, in my opinion, is becoming and has become a lost art form. They play first trumpet now. They're first trumpet players. They're not lead players. When Bill Chase played lead trumpet for Woody Herman, Bill set the sound of the band, in my opinion. A lead trumpet player sets, or used to, set the sound and style of a band. I did with Maynard. I know that. I do know that. I'm not bragging. It's just a matter of fact. But what was the question? I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. We were asking about the other show.
You asked about what?
We were just asking. You answered the right question. We have another question.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to amplify what Stan just said, because Maynard told this to me in front of Stan. And what he said is...
Up in Boston?
Yes. At the Holiday Inn in Peabody.
Can anybody hear him?
Okay. So, here I was, one of the Berklee College Church. There was Eric Miyashiro and Tony Caruso and all these monster players. And we're all going to go on, either Maynard's being or Buddy's being.
Yeah.
And so, Maynard said to us, Stan is not the loudest lead trumpet player. He's not the highest note trumpet player, but you watch. Everybody in my band is matched. Everybody attacks together. Everybody releases together. Everybody phrases exactly the same. And that's not because he plays louder or higher, but because he is such a precise player and he's such a disciplined player. And it doesn't matter whether it's a brand new tune they're sight reading for the first time or tune they've played 1,000 times. They follow Stan from beginning to end of the tune. And I learned a lot. Just
Maynard told you that?
Maynard said it in front of you.
He's a kind of
He must have been drinking, man. Well, yeah. But you're right. To be trumpet player, you have to have a great sound. You have to be consistent. You have to phrase. Phrasing. I don't care if you're playing a Susan March or if you're playing Bluebird. Phrasing is important. I don't care if you're playing the school song that you've been playing too many times. There is no such thing as playing too many times. I did around 2,000 or so concerts with Maynard Ferguson. I'm gonna ask you a question. How many times in over 9 years and over 2,000 concerts do you think I walked off of Maynard's bandstand thinking, I own the book tonight? I just played my tail off tonight. I could not have played any better than I did tonight. How many times, and I'm asking you, how many times do you think I walked off that bandstand thinking I owned the book? How many?
None?
A few more than none. A lot of people think hundreds of times. Six times. Because no matter how many times you play Bluebird Land, how many times you play Intermission, no matter how many times you play Gotta Get You Into My Life, you haven't played it as good as you play. You understand what I'm saying? There's no way that you have played it as good as you can play.
Yep.
That's one of the things that kept me going. A lot of people say, didn't you get tired of playing Birdland? Didn't you get tired of playing Give It One? People would say, I gotta go do a rehearsal. I gotta go do a gig tonight. No, you don't gotta. You don't have to do any of that. Because there are other people that want to do it. Attitude. When I had my band, Kenny will tell you, Kenny played on my band for 3 years, 2-3 years. My last band did. Attitude meant more to me than how much of a hot shot the player.
Amen to that.
What's that?
I said amen to that.
Give me a guy that plays good, that wants to be there, and believe me, and Kenny will tell you this, I'll have that guy playing or that girl playing more better than they ever thought. Am I right, Kenny?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Attitude. Yeah.
I'd like to add to that. I know this is not about me, but I was musical director on the original Love Boat for 20 years.
Oh, cool.
And they'd send me out musicians and young cocky cats and whatever like that. And I'd say to the home office in L.A., I'd say, send me out somebody that's got a great attitude instead of, you know, this awesome musician or whatever like that that has a terrible attitude. When you got a great attitude, you work together better. The music comes out as a better product, you know. Attitude is so much, you know.
Well, absolutely,
it's teamwork.
It's teamwork.
Yeah.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Yeah.
This is for the young guys, and I get this asked a lot. You know, Stan, I think we can all agree that you held one of the most prestigious chairs any trumpet player could ever have. I think we would all agree with that. And with that responsibility, and I'm gonna say responsibility, it's more than, it's not a job, it's a responsibility. And Mike, you can say this from holding the lead chair with Ken. You know, there's times where, you know, you are expected to be here constantly. and there's times where it doesn't happen all that much. We're human, you know. I get asked this for a lot of my students. When you have problems here, you have problems mentally, okay? You know, you're like, oh man, this is too much, this, that, this, that. How can these guys get right back on it? How can they come back from that? What are some of the things they could do to fix their head, you know what I mean? And their jobs.
Wow, Stan, Maynard really missed some things tonight. Yeah, isn't that great? That was my answer. I sold t-shirts on the board. I was the world's greatest t-shirt seller. And so I didn't disagree, but but I also intermingled with people after the show. Wow, Maynard missed some things tonight. And they're gonna expect some, I don't know what they expect from me, but I'm sure they didn't expect me to say, yeah, wasn't it great? Because when Maynard missed, he's still more musical than any trumpet player I would. I loved hearing him miss. Loved it. Did he miss much? No. But, you know, he did it every night. Mike and I were talking earlier. There's no other trumpet player that ever lived or ever will live that can do that. I don't care how old this world's going to be. And I was there. We get off the band bus. And he's on the stage. And you know who had, there's only one person who had more fun than me on that band, and that was Maynard. He had fun. He, you know, and these so-called people that want to put him down, I'm tired of people putting other people down in the music industry. Tired of people put me down. People don't like me. Well, that's, and you don't know me. But we were talking about attitude earlier. Now, the chances of, I don't know how many of you guys are gonna become professional trumpet players, professional musicians. It's tough. And we can talk about attitude and goal setting. But you take attitude, I don't care what kind of job you're going to do. I don't care what kind of a profession you're going to go into. You're not going to be successful with a bad attitude. You're not going to be successful with a bad attitude. You will become successful with a good attitude. I don't care what you do. I don't care if you're a chef. I don't care if you're a doctor. I don't care if you're a trumpet player. Remember that. If you take nothing else away from this time today, you take that.
Yeah. Two-part question.
Sure.
I'm a drummer. Who is your favorite drummer you ever worked with Maynard Ferguson? And also, what was your favorite album that you recorded with Maynard Ferguson?
Okay. My favorite drummer is a guy named Michael Shepard.
It's Bob Shepard's brother, isn't it?
No. Mike Shepard was in the regular Navy music program. I hired him on the band after Pete Erskine left. And Mike was not a flashy drummer. He had incredible chops. Then Mike went, spent about a year and a half out with us, went back into the Navy, ended up in the Commodores, and retired. But Mike needed to do that because he had six kids. But Mike is the best band drummer I've ever played with. You want to talk about a band drummer? He didn't care about anything other than the band and Maynard. is he played the best time that I've ever been around. When he got out of the Navy band, you know, he played, there was a jazz club in Washington, D.C., where they brought all the big, heavy, straight-ahead bebop jazz guys in. They had a house trio and Mike played drums with everybody, with everybody, all the big sax guys and trumpet guys. And he's my favorite drummer. Dave Mancini, who played on that, I love Dave Mancini. There were a couple of drummers I didn't like. Again, I got fired from Maynard's band. That's how I left. Really funny. You know, Maynard knew. We talked about it. I said, you know, you understand, Maynard, I'm not going to leave you. You're going to have to fire me. And it was right after I did my own big band album. And it was just time for me to go. And he knew that I wouldn't leave. And you know, it's time for me to go to my thing, which I did. And I never set myself up to do LA or New York. Neither did Mike Vanek. Okay. Now we're both world class trumpet players, but neither one of us wanted to go to LA or New York. Am I correct? Or we probably could have, but you had to set yourself up politically, to be there. Politics. It's who you know, not how good you are.
And that's true to this day.
Again, in anything you're gonna do. You can take that one away from here today, too. It has nothing to do with me. But, here, well, there I go again. What was
the album? Our favorite album.
The album. Recorded. Okay, I was talking about it. My favorite album. I don't have one. I don't listen to any of the stuff I was on. I listen to Chet Ferretti. And I listen to the old stuff. Chameleon, I like Chameleon. I like New Vintage. I like Storm. So that was my last. That was all I had done here, kind of like, no goes. Real quick story. Anybody know the tune Super Bowl Meets the Band Man?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
It's on the Chameleon now. Quick story. Anybody know who Jay Chataway is? Jay Chataway, in my opinion, is right up there with Willie Mae and Sly Hampton, and as far as a writer is concerned. One of the reasons that Maynard, it was time for me to go, is I felt that people were coming on to Maynard's band for not the right reason. They were coming on the band for themselves. I didn't like that. I also didn't like where the writing was going. Now, who am I to say that? Believe me, I never questioned whose name was on the band front. Not even close. Okay. But things do not stay the same. They're going to change. I didn't like when people said, we're gonna change this country. I don't want you to change this country. I want you to improve this country. I don't want to change the way I play. I want to improve the way I play. I don't want to change my woman. I want to improve my woman. I want to improve myself. I don't want to change myself. But Storm was a great send-off for me because the band was recorded live. We were recording live. There was, and Maynard was too, it was right like this. And Columbia, Maynard lost control of his recording situation. Primal Scream, anybody know? Primal Scream? Mm-hmm. That was Bob James, great musician, great producer, great guy. Maynard hated, I don't like the word hate. Maynard really disliked the fact that his band wasn't used on Primal Scream. There were three of us, a couple guys played a couple songs, but I was in the trumpet section, very honored. First of all, the Maynard would do that. And the trumpet section was Marvin Stamm. There's no better all-around trumpet player in the world than Marvin Stamm. A real jazz player, good lead player, great studio player. John Faddis, in my opinion, is one of the most underrated trumpet players in the world. And Bernie Goodall. What a treat to meet and be on the album, Bernie Goodall, and myself. That was the trumpet section. But Maynard, everybody else was studio. Conquistador, that was kind of a strange album too. I'm trying to think what else. Carnival. Yeah. I was on 9 hours, 8 hours. But Chameleon and Storm. New Vintage or something. But those are, I can't give you one.
How did you like the live album, the live Jimmy's album?
How did I like it? That was right before me.
That's what I thought. Okay.
That was right before me. I don't really have a comment on that album. It's a good band. Charge for good. Maynard just had oral surgery during that album. That was a strange, a lot of people say it's your favorite album. That's fine, I mean, you know.
When did you fit in the other bands?
What's that?
When did you fit in playing with the other bands, Ray Charles and all
that? Ray Charles? I went out with Ray's band January through like May or June of 83 after Maynard. I went out. I had my own band in Sacramento. I was going to be hired to play Dixieland 5 afternoons a week. Great gig in Las Vegas. My band was sort of Dixie Jazz Band. They worked for the same casino owner for 20 years. The band, the gig was Monday through Friday, noon to 5:30.
5.5 hour gig.
Half hour on, half hour off.
Oh, okay.
And they complained about that. But and then we did jazz, you know, because they heard me I was on the Dixieland Jazz Festival, so, which Mike was also. And had a very successful band on that. And that's where they heard me and offered me this gig. And I took a guy, Finney Tanno's place, who was a trumpet player, I think, family down in Miami. But, while waiting for that gig, I went out with Glenn Miller band on Area 1, Larry Lynn. What a band, what a book. I mean, to play the real Glenn Miller book, I was just honored. And then when I played with Sly Zenter's band, I was living in Vegas. Sly was in Vegas at the time, so that's when did I answer?
Yeah. I have a question, Stan. This is again kind of asking questions a lot of my students ask, and so I'd rather you answer this. What is when you're looking for when you're going to go to college, or you're looking for a private instructor? What are some of the things you should look for in a good teacher slash mentor?
Just because somebody's a great player doesn't mean they're a great teacher. At all. What do you look for? I would say reputation more than anything. You can learn something from everybody. I took some lessons from Dr. Donald Reinhardt in Philadelphia when I was in Concord. I took a couple of some lessons from Claude Gordon in LA. I love Pendleton. I like it. Both of these guys, neither one of them talked about music. But they talked about all the other aspects of trumpet, which totally bored me, to be honest with you. This thing about a certain lead part, weighted valve count, and all this crap, that to me means nothing. I've never really ever played a horn I didn't really like. I endorsed the MF horn with Holton. I then was with the Bench Company for a while, when I did Besson and my last trumpet, which I love. They gave me a vintage comb. Great horn. No better trumpet in the world than that horn. My favorite horn that I ever played on Maynard's band was the 7X Bench.
You want to tell the kids what you mouthpiece you played on?
When I went, I played a box set in C up until I went on Maynard's band. I mean, you know, I didn't have a problem with it. He cut me every now and then. That's about it. You know, I mean, you know, and I was playing lead on still in 17, but I was cutting a little bit more. To me, there's no such thing as no pressure playing. But the point is, you use your whole body and not just gear. But so I was Bill Ratchenberg, who owned and ran Jeff Tone Mouthpiece. Now, when I was in the Commodores, they, first of all, King sent us 6 silver flare trumpets. And we could each choose one. And I didn't like any of them. The other 3 guys did, and I was playing a Chicago Bench. But they also sent us this big, huge box came that was Jet Tone mouthpieces. This was like 1970. I'm Jet Tone. We're all laughing. How stupid I was at some points in my life. So I knew Maynard had started playing that Bill Ratzenberg or Maynard's mouthpiece. So we were up in somewhere in Connecticut, and I talked to Bill, and he said, "Let's go to the factory." He took me to the factory, and of course, at that time, it was really hip. And if you had your own mouthpiece, your own model mouthpiece. Yeah, man, I got the Stan Martin model mouthpiece. or I got the Stan Mark model trumpet. Well, that's all funny. So I said to Bill, I said, why don't you, you know, a little bit shallower. So he made six or seven mouthpieces for me on the lathe. None of them worked. I didn't like any of them. But he said, here, here's another one. Put it in the horn, put it up to my chaps. That was the one. It worked. It worked. I said, what are the specs on this? He said, I just took it off the shelf. It's one of my regular, it's a studio B jet tones. Now I'm gonna tell you guys something, all you young guys especially. Believe me, I expect you all to go out and buy a studio B model jet tone because it's the only mouthpiece in the world to play. What's that?
Goodbye.
That is so far from the truth. Thank goodness we're in a church, or we've been lightning here. But there is no best mouthpiece. There is no best horn, trumpet. There is no best car, is there? Is there a best model car? I'm gonna assume that no answer means no.
Stan?
Yeah.
Let me just add something. Yeah. When the way he put the question.
Speak up, Mike.
I'm gonna add something about the way he put the question about teachers.
About what?
About teachers.
Yeah.
My basic premise, if anybody asks me about a teacher, is if you go to a teacher who has everybody playing on the same mouthpiece, and it's a 1.5 C, run the other way as fast as you can. Because first of all, this premise that they have of, oh, you can't get a good sound if you don't have a great big mouthpiece is such a bunch of bull.
Yeah.
You know, a smaller mouthpiece gives you a brighter sound, a larger mouthpiece gives you a darker sound. That's the only difference. Bill Chase played a 6A4A. My God, I can't get a sound on that mouthpiece.
He had a humongous sound.
Well, thank you, Mike. To me, you sound like you want to sound. I don't know how old I am, but here's an old singer who didn't sing very well, but he got lucky. The only time I use the word luck is when you're talking slot machines, winning on a slot machine, or in the music industry. This guy got lucky. He was also married to Liz Taylor for a while, but he was a singer and made his living at it and made a lot of money. And he recorded a song that my mom and dad had, and I used to play it on their Victrola. And in the middle is this beautiful trumpet solo. And it goes, wa-da-da-da-da-da-da-wa-da-da-da-do-da, wa-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-wa. Who knows what that song is?
Oh, my papa.
Exactly. And I've never been able to find out, Michael, who did that solo. I don't know. I've looked, and I just heard Claude Gordon did. But that trumpet sound was put in my ears. I'm going to give everybody some things to leave here with. Some albums in it that I have. A lot of them. I'm going to have a couple things if you want to purchase them, like real cheap, they're fine. But I'm going to give everybody at least three things to take home. One of them is a tribute to Harry James. I put it together to get the Harry James Band to be the leader of the Ghost Band, which I should have gotten. We did this video and the whole bit in Vegas. Mike, I don't know if you know this. And a good band, great singer. And sent it to Pee Wee Money. And as soon as he found out that it was the Screech player with Maynard Ferguson, the Screech player, where he came up with that.
Maynard hated that term, huh?
Oh, I hate the term too. So does Mike. Yeah. And anyway, but sent it up to him, and I don't think he ever listened to it. But we made CDs. I don't know, I'm going to give you one of those two. I'm going to give you a CD of my swing band with Kenny is actually on the band. That was one of my bands in Las Vegas, good band. And I'm going to give everybody a CD that I recorded with my young band up in Medford, Oregon. Michael heard that band. And we played all of my stuff. And I had five people in that band who were high school seniors. The band will major. But I'm going to give everybody a copy of those two. You can play them once, throw them away, whatever you want to do. But I think you'll enjoy them.
So Stan, we have enough time because I want everyone to be able to talk with you on an individual basis and be able to sign some CDs and everything. So we have just enough time for a couple more questions. Does anybody else have any more questions?
Yeah, Kenny.
Okay, I think maybe it's a two-part question. Number one, you're over 30, so what would you tell your 16-year-old self about either trumpet playing or about the music business, about some of the different hats that one might wear as a musician? Because some of these kids here, no one knows exactly what's going to happen, only they do. But something that maybe, something that somebody either didn't tell you that you wish they did, or something that you wish that someone told you when you were that age, as far as music career, playing the trumpet specifically, or wearing some of the many hats that you've worn throughout your career, trumpet player, contractor, band leader, singer, you know, all that stuff.
Well, first I want to say something. I'm going to try to answer that question. That's a wide variety there, Kenny, but I'll try to answer it. But what I wanted to, and Kenny will attest to this, because Kenny has become a band leader and a very successful member after a few times with me, but he was also a band leader, becoming a band leader when he was with me, too. But there's something. First of all, you need to find yourself a good lady, an auntie, I know Michael has one, I now know Kenny has one, and I certainly know you have one.
That's the truth. God bless her.
And, and I certainly have been. Because they do everything. Nobody sees me do it. They do everything. But something that Kenny has heard me say is you're in situations even now. You have mom and dad. Some of you might have a part-time job. Some of you are in bands, whether it be for your mom and dad, whether it be for your boss at your job, or whether it be for your band leader, whether it's on a professional level, or a high school level, or a semi-professional level. Two things. You either make the job of your mom and dad, or your band leader, harder, or you make it what, Kenny?
Easy.
Or you make it easier. There's no way. It's like a tree is either growing or it's dying. Nothing in the middle. Paint on a fence post is either decaying or it's getting newer. There's nothing in the middle. Your relationship with your lady is either getting stronger or it's getting weaker. You guys will all find that out. What do you want to do? You want to make it what? What? What do you want to make it? You want to make it stronger. So make your band leader's job easier. Do not make it harder. And the other people in the band, if you're helping to move equipment and the other guys put you down, that's their problem, not your problem. I wanted to say that. Kenny, what would I only understood that, and I'm glad, really. I only understood that it was a business after I became a band leader. I didn't understand that Maynard needed to make money to support his family. I didn't quite understand that. As brilliant as I have been my whole life, and because to me, music is about emotion and loving what you're doing. Remember that when you're out doing a gig, that it's possible that somebody is sitting in your audience. This could be the last live music that that person ever hears in their life. Their life could be cut short tomorrow, today. You understand how important it is that you play your asses off every time you put the horn up to your chops. Every time you take that pair of drumsticks, you go. And I didn't have time for people that didn't have that attitude. That's why I'm not liked by everybody. That's cool with me. That means they really didn't know me. And that's okay too. Because I don't like most people anyway. I like my cats and my wife.
Is that completed?
Kenny, I'm trying.
I know that was a pretty long question, but you, like I said, you guys got some value out of what he just said, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
That was my point of asking the question.
Cool. Thank you.
My question is, a lot of people who have never been on the road, I think it's quite glamorous. Those of us that have been on the road know that the music, assuming you're playing with great players, is wonderful, but 90% of it is very rough. It's a very grueling lifestyle, one-nighters, especially grabbing a meal here, grabbing a few hours sleep there. Can you talk about how the tough part of being on the road and how it affects your health, emotional, and mental state?
Yeah, I can address all that. Now, next question. I'm a road rat, man.
Well, quick, Tom, when I asked him, I said, okay, well, we're going to book you a flight, this, that. No, I'm going to drive. That's a road dog. that to me, my, I was like, this man is, yeah.
He probably took side roads all the way here.
I mean,
from Florida?
Reno.
Oh, that's right, Reno.
The road was never booming to me. The road was never booming to me. Mayor was on the road this whole time. Grabbing a meal here and there, what an adventure. a great adventure. From Ted's hot dog stand, I saw a buffalo, to Don's seafood house in Lafayette, Louisiana, to Bookbinders in Philadelphia, to Pat's Steaks in Philadelphia.
Just like you.
Huh?
Just like you. McDonald's right here in Phoenix.
And McDonald's here in the city.
No, we didn't take them to McDonald's.
It was
Burger King.
It was never grueling at all. To me, now,
10-hour bus ride.
Who cares? I mean, look what you're doing at the end of the 10 hours. What did I do at the end of the 10 hours? Oh, I get a chance to hear Maynard Ferguson. I get a chance to play with Maynard. I get a chance to feel the joy and happiness from the art.
Amen. Amen.
That's what it's all about. It's not about us. It's about what's out front. You know? Again, can't even tell you. When the audience is happy, that's my number one. Then I need the band to be happy. That's an opportunity. Then I need my wife to be happy. No. And then I'm happy. I mean, what else is it? And I played with an incredible band every night. I don't remember anything. That's why I was like, hey, I gotta go do a gig tonight. Well, then don't go. Get somebody, go and become a custodian or something. Maybe you'll be happy at that. Maybe you'll look forward to doing it. Now, I've had a blessed life, a blessed career. I always said, I wish everyone on the face of the earth could have the feeling that I had for over 9 years, just one time in the world, the feeling I had going on that dance floor, whether it been in a funky jazz club somewhere at Carnegie Hall, or the theater, it was on there. There's one thing I'm going to get into.
Yeah, go ahead. You got it.
Now, you're not going to believe this, but I'm telling you the truth.
Oh, wow.
I assume all you guys here in the front row are trumpet players, is that right?
I'm a trumpet player.
You're a trumpet player?
Yes.
Okay. No,
I did that for you, Kenny.
Thanks.
That's okay. Are any of you guys baseball players? You are. Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. What position do you play?
I play outfield.
You play outfield. Okay. You're left fielder, right fielder?
Usually left fielder.
So you're out in left field. Mm-hmm. You have your baseball uniform on. You're running out to the field. What kind of position are you going to be in with your body when the first guy comes up to the plate and the pitcher gets ready to pitch? I want you to do it. Right, exactly. Now, let me ask you this. If I was playing left field and I was out there and my gloves in my left hand and I'm And here's the first pictures getting ready to go. What do I look like?
You've got one out there.
Right. What do you look like when you're like this?
Exhausted.
Huh?
It looks like you're exhausted.
No. That wrong out. I'm not looking for that answer. What's that?
Like you look ready.
Like you're ready. The answer I'm looking for is you look like a baseball player. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Anybody know where I'm going with this? Anybody at all? Before you can be a baseball player, you have to what? Come on, somebody say it. You have to look like a baseball player. Am I right? Before you can be a trombone player, before you can be a trumpet player, what answer am I looking for? You have to look like a trumpet player. I love when I'm seeing a band sitting. Oh, do I? You think I like to see that? What?
Nothing. I hear an echo in here.
Or if they're standing. I love to see this. You telling me, do I look like a trumpet player? You can't be a trumpet player or a trombone player if you don't first look like one. Remember that. Remember that if you teach. Now, I'm going to try something. I want you to believe this. I'm in a church. I haven't played one note on this since I played Happy Birthday to a 90-year-old man about 4 weeks ago who saw you and I doing Bill at the Theater in the Round over in up and up upstate California.
Yeah.
You did that justice.
In Circle Square Theater.
So
yeah.
90 years old, Mike. And before that, I didn't play since October when I played Happy Birthday to my wife. I'm a kid. Now, I don't know what's going to come out. Might be nothing. Okay? But I want you to keep in mind, I haven't played, I haven't warmed up at all. Now, let's see what happens. I have a balance problem in my old age. I'll be 72.
Just getting started, man.
In a couple weeks. So I'm going to sit down. I sit down at this experiment. Still have going for myself.
Beautiful sound.
Thank you.
Gorgeous sound.
What made that sound?
Came out of your head.
Came out of my head?
Yeah. You already had
it.
You knew what you wanted.
The answer I'm looking for. Those are good answers. But the answer I'm
looking
for. You
look like a trumpet player.
Air is energy. Okay. Remember that. And it's really funny. Mike Shepherd, my favorite drummer, used to breathe with the band. Mike and I used to talk about playing chord notes. And I was a real nut on releases. A nut. I can analyze a lead trumpet part for you, you would have no clue. And most professional players, if not all, wouldn't have a clue on what's in my mind on phrasing. Climax of a phrase. You ever hear that? There are climaxes to phrasing. Now, did it come across like da ba da da? No, it didn't. You have to over-exaggerate everything. If you think you're playing double forte, it's not coming across that way. Even if you're playing double piano, you have to exaggerate that too. My opinion. Now, you know, I gave you some opinions too. And I'm very opinionated. But I need to tell you that these are my opinions. What I tell you, just like I said, this mouthpiece worked for me. Everybody is different. Everybody is different. We all like different cards. We all like different food. We all like different teachers, and that's okay. The thing about teachers, you learn at least one thing. If you learn one thing today, you walk out of here a winner. I hope you did. And I hope you teach in your lifetime too, whether you become formal teachers or not. A lot of you, most of you, become parents. You want to talk about teaching? I've never had children. Never fit into my lifestyle. I was on the road. But we're all teachers. Take it seriously. Because, you know, we need to all help each other. A couple more?
Well, I'll take one more question, and then we have to wrap it up.
Yeah.
So I can.
You mentioned that you play swing, big band, and Dixieland also.
Yeah.
It's probably important not to show up and play the same way for different gigs.
Absolutely.
So can you kind of tell us how you approach that?
Sure. Let's one of my favorite big band charts to play is In the Mood. And I was conducting for this Frank Sinatra lookalike guy, Rick Sinatra, and we were doing the big Seagram's convention in Coronado off San Diego at that old hotel. So an old Navy friend of mine named Marty Conley, good drummer, put together, I used his band, and we did all Sinatra stuff, plus I had stuff too, and I took In the Mood on. And guys, people like to put down that chart in the mood. Okay. So anyway, I call up In the Mood to rehearse. We do a sound check. And I just let the band play. So I call up In the Mood. So here's this jazz tenor player. Now I always put my jazz tenor player on stage right of the same section. So, I pick up an attitude immediately from this guy. So it comes to the saxophone. Whether it's alto and tenor and alto, it's a very famous, just like the trumpet solo. Ba da ba, you know, whenever I have played in the movement, I play the written trumpet solo. It's what you do on that trumpet. If you do anything else, it's sacrilegious, in my opinion. You know, and it's the same way with the alto. So this guy starts playing all of his John Coltrane stuff. Hey man, that really sounds good. I need you guys to play what's written. I looked at Marty back in the trumpet section. And Marty went, I said, pack up your stuff, I didn't use stuff, and get it off my hands. I fired right on the spot. Right at the I says, Marty, I said, if you want to get somebody tonight, fine. If not, we'll go with four saxes. I said, you know what's fine with me. And I said, make sure you get somebody that would like to sit in this band from the beginning. And he brought somebody in. And the alto player had no problem. When, first of all, I have never, nor would I ever, consider myself a jazz trumpet player. I am not what I would consider a real jazz trumpet player. However, I probably play better jazz than 80% of the people that sing it. But you don't go on a Dixie line gig and play alto or and play clarinet and tenor. And if you're playing Bourbon Street Parade, you don't play it like John Coltrane. You play it like Sam Butera. Sam Butera was an incredible tenor player, played with Lee Kramer for years, that a lot of mainstream guys would put down. They would put some. I love how much we put down people. But you have to figure out what kind of gig it is and take those chops to the gig. When I played concert, I didn't attack things like I did when I played lead trumpet. It's a totally mindset, different mindset. But you change it up here. You change it up here. And isn't it wonderful to have all those chops you don't need? How much trumpet playing is done between low C and 2 octave high C? That's where most of it is done. Probably 95% of it. At least 95%. Michael, maybe you mean that, right?
They call that the cash register.
Did I answer your question? You guys didn't ask me anything.
His time is coming and so is his, so don't worry about that.
Okay.
But if one of you guys want to ask a question, please feel free to.
Yeah.
I was going to ask, after you played in the Navy band and after you played in the Navy band, like, what were your goals after that?
Good question.
Boy, that's a great question.
That is a good question.
My goal was to have the next working on the road big room. I wanted a bus, I wanted the kind of bus to sit in the right front end seat. I did that one time where I was called by Tom Cassidy to put together a Jimmy Dorsey orchestra, which I did. Because Cassidy was sick. I put together the Jimmy Dorsey orchestra, went out and bought all Jimmy Dorsey stuff, rehearsed the band, including we did four-part harmony stuff on I'll Never Smile Again, and I took the band over to California someplace. I was living in Sacramento, and we went over WDB, right? But I had my own bus, and I sat in the right front seat for 1 year. But my goal was to have the next big band. I brought along 4 or 5 vinyl long LPs, I understand vinyl's coming back, of my big band album that I did in 1982. It's an incredible album. Trumpeter's Prayer is on there. The arrangement's better and I play better than Gospel. That's worth the album. But did I answer your?
Yeah.
Just want to ask something, man? Sure.
Okay.
Well, here's the thing, guys. First of all, Stan, it's been an honor to actually sit on the same stage as you. I'm gonna just say this, you know, for those of you who don't know you're in a very, very, you're in a very good position as far as being a player in this town, because there's so many avenues that you can go see. You know, there's accolades, there's people here with accolades that you can't hear about. Mr. Vax over there spent, was it 10 years with Ken?
No, about 3.
3, yeah. And then there's Nick Cooper, who's played league with Commodores for 10 years. He retired. There's Bruce Gates, played with the Urban Note for 20 years.
What's his name?
Bruce Gates. And there's a lot more that I came from. You got Dan Reed over here, who's done cruise ships for 20 years. There's a plethora of resources here that you need to take advantage of. And I am so glad that we were able to stand. If we ask you back next year, would you come back?
Sure, right.
Would you guys be willing to see Stan again next year?
It's, yeah. It's, I told you we wouldn't have any problem with time. What time is it?
I know.
And I don't lie about this. I give you my opinion. But it's my opinion. It's not etched in stone. It doesn't mean that that's the way it is. Now, there are certain things that I'm very strong about. But just remember, music is fun and joy. It's happiness. God blessed us with talent. That's why I was such a good player, because God blessed me. And that's what I was supposed to do. There's no doubt in my mind that I was put on this planet to play lead trumpet for me. There's no doubt. And
yep. Well, guys, again, if you want, Stan, if you want, go ahead and give your CDs out.
Yeah.
We actually have Sharpies if you want Stan to sign them, or if you guys want to take pictures with Stan, that's awesome. So let's go ahead and do that. And again, Stan, thank you so much, man.
You're welcome.
Good.
Hey, Jerry, I was just thinking, because there's these steps right there.
Yeah.
If you move the stand out of the way, we could get like everybody that came here with Stan, and get Stan in front and Mike Jackson.
He doesn't want to take a picture with you, Dan.
No, but
anybody but a drummer.
All of us get a picture all together.
That's fine. We can do that as well. I'm up for anything. But if you guys want to, Stan, if you want to go ahead and give us the ease and do whatever you got to do, man. Stan, thank you so much for the lesson.
Always have fun. Mm-hmm. Always have fun.
Hey Dad, do you need a moment still?
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
Well, I had a good time.